nature sing, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing.
I like your card, but I'm absolutely not paying an annual fee.
All right, good evening. How's everyone doing this evening? Good to see you all that made it out. We're just going to sing some Christmas songs this evening, just kind of for your pleasure, so you guys can stay seated. We have a couple songs, and then Dave's going to come up and share a lovely message with us this evening. Merry Christmas, everybody.
Follow the star to a place unexpected. Would you believe, after all we've projected, a child in a manger? Lowly and small, the weakest of all, unlikeliest hero, wrapped in his mother's shawl, just a child. Is this who we've waited for? 'Cause how many kings stepped down from their thrones, and how many lords have abandoned their homes, and how many greats have become the least for me? And how many gods have poured out their hearts to romance a world that is torn all apart? And how many fathers gave up their sons for me? Bringing our gifts for the newborn Savior, all that we have, whether costly or meek, because we believe. Gold for his honor, and frankincense for his pleasure, and myrrh for the cross he'll suffer. Do you believe? Is this who we've waited for? 'Cause how many kings stepped down from their thrones, and how many lords had abandoned their homes, and how many greats have become the least for me? And how many gods have poured out their hearts to romance a world that is torn all apart? And how many fathers gave up their sons for me? Only one did that for me. All for me. All for you. All for me. All for you. 'Cause how many kings stepped down from their thrones, and how many lords have abandoned their homes, and how many greats have become the least for me? And how many gods have poured out their hearts to romance a world that is torn all apart? And how many fathers gave up their sons for me? Only one did that for me.
Sing this song to you.
child, they search the inn to find a place for you. We're coming soon. There was no room for them to stay, so in a manger filled with hay, God's only son was born. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. The shepherds left their flocks by night to see this baby wrapped in light. A host of angels led them all to you. It was just as the angel said. Shone bright up in the east to Bethlehem. The wise men three came many miles and journeyed along for you into the place at which you were. Their frankincense and gold and myrrh they gave to you, and they cried out, hallelujah. This baby boy would grow to be a man and one day die for me and you. My sins would drive the nails in you. That rugged cross was my cross too. Still every breath you drew.
Star and angels gave the sign. Bow to babe on bended knee. The
Jesus is the reason for the season. When we say that Christmas is not about the presents, but try selling that to a seven-year-old. I mean, let's just be honest. Nothing can pollute the atmosphere of a Christmas morning like a really bad gift. I mean, you have that sense of anticipation. You've waited all year, and then it's just a big letdown. I come from a long line of bad gift givers, so this has kind of become second nature for me. Christmas of 97, my aunt gave me a watch. Great gift. But when I thanked her for it, all she said was, uh-oh. She explained to me that the watch was for Chris on the other side of the family. When I was 16 years old, my mom gave me a floor lamp. A floor lamp. Like, what 16-year-old boy is walking into his nasty laundry-covered bedroom saying, you know, the lighting in here is just not quite right. But the mother of all bad gifts came to me when I was 8 years old, Christmas 1986, at my grandparents' farm. They were successful farmers and had a long track record of giving awesome gifts. So here we are, Christmas morning, Grandma brings out the best and final gift, the big one. My little 8-year-old heart is just pounding. I mean, this is my Christmas. I rip through the paper, open the top, I look inside, and I'm stunned. You should know, my grandparents were very resourceful. Grandma would can food from their garden. She repurposed milk cartons. You know, she'd save old jeans just for their fabric. So I peered into the box just a second time just to confirm that what I was seeing really was a handmade quilt. Apparently, Grandma had taken some of Grandpa's old jeans and combined that with some recycled kitchen curtains that were fruit-themed. And this quilt was just a marvel. It had bananas and apples and little grape clusters just for a pop of color. A quilt? A stinking quilt? Are you kidding me? What am I gonna do with the quilt? I'm 8! But after I had some time to think about it, that's when I cried. That's when I really broke down, you know. I just remember the next day packing up the van and we were leaving. I just felt so let down, and I was just wallowing in my own self-pity the entire trip home. I mean, I was warm, but a funny thing happened as the months and years went by. I started to fall in love with that blanket. It became my bedspread, my traveling blanket, my house blanket, my watching football blanket. I used it so much that it became tattered and worn. The once bright red backing faded to a light pink. Light pink on one side, fruit and jeans on the other. But I didn't care. Like, I used it every day. And somehow, the mother of all bad gifts turned into the best gift I ever got. But when I first peered into that box, I couldn't see the years of joy that that blanket would give me. I completely undervalued what I'd been given. And today, when I look at that crazy jean and fruit blanket, it reminds me that there's another gift that, quite frankly, I've undervalued. The gift of Jesus. The most undervalued gift in the history of mankind. His hope, his joy, his peace, his love has come to us as a gift. But is it real to me? Am I really experiencing it? Are you really experiencing it? Are we just so caught up in the craziness and distraction of the season that that incredible gift has faded off into the background somewhere? I pray today finds me able to cherish both the unexpected gift of that first Christmas and the promise of Jesus being always with us now, that his hope, love, joy, and peace would be even more clear to me than ever. I pray the same for you. God is with us. Merry Christmas.
Amen. Merry Christmas to all of you. Thank you so much for coming with us, coming out tonight and celebrating Christmas Eve. We're so psyched that you're here with us, and we're so grateful that you've come out. How many of you know Jesus truly is the reason for the season? Amen. Wow, there's a lot of people here. I didn't know that you would all be here. I would have prepared something better if I would have known this many people were coming. No, I'm just kidding. It's all good. Amen. I love Christmas. It's my favorite holiday. And I think that as you get older, you really, truly do learn to appreciate every gift that you get. Amen. And the older that you get, the more appreciative you are. And I remember thinking, I can't wait for Christmas to get here. I'll get new socks. You know you're getting old when you get psyched up about the socks, because all my socks have got holes in the toes. I mean, my toenails are chipped from the ends of my shoes. I needed those socks, so thank you, Mom. Socks and T-shirts. You get excited about the little things, and I can't overemphasize how great the gift of God with us is. And the truth is that God with us is Jesus, and we've been talking about this over the last several weeks, the concept of Emmanuel, the fact that God invaded human history in the form of a baby and changed our world forever. And because he came and because he gave the gift of himself, we all can have eternal life. It's the greatest story ever told. There will never be another story that's greater than the story of Christmas, the story of God with us, and the story of Emmanuel. And I want to talk about that, Emmanuel. And I have an excerpt from a sermon that was preached back in 1854. C.H. Spurgeon said this about Emmanuel. He said, "It is wisdom's mystery, God with us. Sages look at it and wonder. Angels desire to see it and understand it. The plumb line of reason cannot reach halfway into its depths. The eagle wing of science cannot fly so high as to grasp it, and the piercing eye of the vulture of research cannot see it. It is God with us. God with us is hell's terror. Satan trembles at the sound of it. His legions fly away. The black-winged dragon of the pit quails before it. Let Satan come to you suddenly, and all you have to whisper is, 'God with us,' and back he falls, confounded and confused. Satan trembles when he hears that name, Emmanuel. It is the laborer's strength. How can we preach the gospel or bend our knees in prayer? How can the missionary go into foreign lands? How can the martyr stand at the stake? How can the confessor own his Lord and Master? How can people labor if that word Emmanuel is taken away from us? None of it is possible unless God is with us. God with us is the sufferer's comfort. It's the alleviation of his misery. It's the sleep that God gives to those he loves. It's the rest after exertion and toil. God with us is eternity's sonnet. It's heaven's hallelujah. It's the shout of the glorified. It's the song of the redeemed. It's the chorus of angels. It is the everlasting of the great orchestra of the sky. That's what God with us is. Do you truly understand how powerful and how profound Emmanuel is? You see, when God came, he came to stay. God didn't just show up for a one-night-only event or for a one-time, once-in-a-lifetime event. No, he came and he gave the greatest gift of all. And it's the gift that truly continues and keeps on giving. The gift of salvation also gives us the gifts of the Spirit. And it also gives us the gift of fellowship and membership into the body of Christ, which is the church. All of that is possible because of God with us, because of Jesus with us. So tonight, I don't want us to undervalue or underappreciate that gift. I know you're already looking at your tree, and some of you are already seeing the presence there, and you're imagining what it could be. Hopefully it's not a fruit blanket for you, unless you need a fruit blanket. But don't miss the true reason, the true meaning behind this season that we celebrate called Christmas, because it's all about the gift that God gave us. Don't lose the wonder of the gift of Jesus. And I want to talk about four things that I think God with us brings. The first one is this. It's that unshakable hope, which we've talked about a few weeks ago. But it's the hope that the Savior has been born. The hope that Isaiah the prophet spoke about 700 years before Christ's birth. And it was the hope that was born after 400 years of silence. God said, here he is. He will be born in a manger. He will be born in Bethlehem. And then Jesus was born. And when he was born, hope was born. And as the angel said, for unto you a child is born, and for unto us a son is given, and he is the Savior who is called Christ the Lord. Notice what they said. A child is born, and the son is given. But the son had always existed eternally. It was Christ, but on Christmas Day, he came into the world. It's the hope of salvation. It's the hope that the Savior will return. The hope that there is eternal life after death and there is abundant life in the here and now. It's the hope that life has meaning and that there is nothing that can take that salvation away from us. If you don't have Jesus, you don't have that hope. If you don't have Jesus in your life, if he's not your Lord and Savior, then that hope is not yours. It's the hope that the Bible calls the anchor of our soul. It's the hope that in the darkest night and in the deepest storm, that hope keeps us secure and safe and trusting in our everlasting and eternal God. It's our blessed hope. It's the believer's hope. It's the hope of Jesus Christ. And tonight, I hope you have that hope, unshakable hope. The second thing is unstoppable love. We know the verses, we talked about it yesterday morning, that God demonstrated his love when he sent Jesus to lie in a manger and commanded him to be hung on a cross. It was the love that was demonstrated by heaven giving its best for you and for me. That was the love. It's the love that nothing can separate us from. Romans chapter 8 says that tribulation, nor distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword. For as it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long, and we are like sheep that are ready to be slaughtered. Even when your life is like that, you're still not separated from the love of God. Even when your life is in that pit, you're still not separated from the love of God. It goes on to say, no, in all of these things, in the worst of things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. It's that unstoppable love that God has. Paul said, I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, or the things to come, or powers, or height, or depth, nor anything in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Jesus Christ our Lord. Christmas is the day that love was given to the world. It's the love that loves anyway. It's the love that took the risk. It's the love that gave all that it had. It's the love that drives out fear and reassures us and affirms us and saves us. God is love and love is God. And that love is the priceless gift that once you receive it, all you want to do is give it away. Unstoppable love. If you don't have Jesus, you don't have that love. Unshakable hope. Unstoppable love. And the third is unspeakable joy. Now I want to talk about this one for a little bit longer because joy is something that is supposed to be decorated and celebrated all Christmas, right? Your Christmas decorations that say joy. This is the season of joy. Joy to the world, right? But when I look around at our world, I see that there is a lack of joy. I see that there's more medication that's being prescribed because of a lack of joy. There's more tragedy and turmoil on the news because of a lack of joy. For many people, this season is anything but joyful, and all people can think about is who they've lost and what they've lost and dealing with pain and suffering and those painful reminders, the bitter loneliness that comes when you look across the room and you see the empty chair, especially at Christmas time. I want to speak to you today and tell you that you could still have joy because Jesus gives the fullness of joy. Through Jesus, there can still be joy, even though it's missing in our world and even though it may be missing in our life, we can still have joy. And here's the truth about joy. Joy needs a noun. I want you to think about that for a minute. Joy needs a noun. It's dependent on interaction. Joy is dependent on interaction. You can't just have joy for joy's sake. There has to be a reason. There has to be something that inspires joy. Joy can only be produced or experienced in relation to a person, a place, or a thing. Joy is a response. It's an emotional response. It's an emotional reaction. And I think about the other day when Micah and I are playing video games and you know, I love that my son's getting older because now father and son bonding time is video game time. And I'm a gamer from way back. I was playing Atari, I was playing Frogger, Mario, and Donkey Kong, and all those old school games. I still got a Nintendo. I keep it real. I love video games. And Mike and I get to play. But he doesn't like my old games. He likes the new games, and his favorite game right now is Fortnite. Well, I have never won a round of Fortnite, ever. And I have never even been close to winning. I mean, you start off with 100 people. I'm usually like 98th dead. I mean, that's my best place was like 97th. And I thought that was a big victory. We're playing Fortnite, and it comes down to there's three people left in the match, and two of them are us. It's me and Micah, and there's this one other guy. And we're like, oh, my goodness, we're so close. We're going to get the dub, right, which dub is short for W, and W is short for the win. So that's what it meant something different when I was a kid, but that means win now. So we're going to get the dub, and we're fighting, and this guy is building. He's like building a stairway to heaven, and he's going up, and he's running up, and I got a rocket launcher. I mean, how cool is that? And so I, pshaw, pshaw, and I'm rapid firing rockets, and I see his bridge, doo, 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 and that guy's falling. Then Micah runs over, and he builds a little ramp, and he jumps up, and he goes, and the guy dies, and the thing pops up. It says Victory Royale, and we're like, oh, my goodness, we won. We won. I was doing the jubilation dance. Micah's doing the floss, and we're just like freaking out. We won, and we had such joy in that moment. There was a real tangible. It is 12:45 in the morning, and I'm going, let's go, come on. And Laura is coming out, what are you guys doing? Michael, we got the dub, we won. And it was such a joyful moment. And I said, turn it off right now. Turn it off. We're not playing the game again for another week. We're going to relish this moment. Why? Because as great as that joy was and as real as that joy was, guess what? The next morning when we woke up, that joy was gone. And we got back on the game, and we tried to play another round, and we got killed right away, and that joy was fleeting. That joy. The reason why we don't have sustainable joy is because we try to put it in the wrong things. We try to find it in these things that won't last, and we try to find it in our duck boots and in our crossbows and in all this stuff that aren't going to last. They're not sustainable. And you've got to put your joy in something that will not change and that will not fade. And that's why your joy should be put in Jesus. because he's not going anywhere. And through Christ, you're always a victor. With Jesus Christ, it's victory royale every single day because he conquered death, hell, and the grave. You got to put your joy in the right place so that it can be. David said this. He said, "Restore unto me the joy of my salvation." That's what the Holy Spirit gives us. And if you're not experiencing joy tonight, it's probably because you're not experiencing God. You have no relationship with God. You've never confessed and repented of your sin and put your hope and had a real living relationship in Jesus, because that is the only place where joy can be sustained. Joy needs Jesus. Joy needs him, and you need him. And I need him. This is what Dr. John Piper said. He said, "Christian joy is a good feeling in the soul produced by the Holy Spirit as he causes us to see the beauty of Christ in the Word and in the world." It's produced by the Holy Spirit when we see the beauty of Christ through his Word and in his world. If you're not experiencing joy, you're probably not experiencing God. First Peter said it this way. He said, "Even though you haven't seen Christ, you love him. Though you don't see him now, you believe in him, and you rejoice with joy that's unspeakable and full of glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your soul." That's what the relationship with Jesus produces. Salvation. Salvation produces joy. And it produces joy that is so great you can't even speak about it. You get so overwhelmed and so full of the joy of the Lord that you can't even put it into words. When's the last time? We had that game, and we had that awesome moment, that awesome Fortnite moment, and I got to thinking the next day, when was the last time my relationship with God produced that kind of joy in my life? So many of us are searching for happiness and joy, and we're looking in all the wrong places. Friends, joy needs Jesus. Because we all need Jesus. I love what Robert Schuller said. He said this, "Joy is not the absence of suffering. It is the presence of God." Joy is not the absence of suffering. Joy is not that everything is going right and everything is rainbows and butterflies. And every time you open the door, there's a trumpeter of chorus playing out. "I feel happy." That's not what joy is. Joy is not the absence of trouble. Joy is the presence of Jesus. Because if he's present, you can have joy in all things and through all things. When you can't have joy in the situation, God can give you joy through the situation. As you anticipate the joy of Christmas, I want us all to remember that it's only found through a relationship with Jesus Christ. And lastly, we have indescribable peace because God is with us. Indescribable peace. It's the peace of God that Philippians says surpasses all human understanding. It's the peace of God that guards your heart and your mind. It's the peace of God that even though you're in the midst of the storm, you know everything will turn out for God's glory and for my good in the end, because God gives you that peace. I think that that's the result of Mary and Joseph. Throughout this Christmas story, as they're in an impossible situation, as Joseph and Mary are pledged to be married and wedded together, and then Mary finds out from the angel that she's going to have a baby, and then she tells Joseph that she's pregnant, and Joseph finds out, and in the midst of that shameful, dramatic, and very, very crazy situation for the time, I believe they had the peace of God. Why? Because they were obeying God even throughout the hard situation. And the peace of God is always the result of obedience to God. So if you don't have peace in your soul tonight, you have to ask yourself, am I obeying the Word of God? Am I obeying the commandments of God? Because the peace of God is the result of God with us. It calms us and gives us security in the midst of troubled times and uncertain days. And I want you to examine your heart tonight. Do you have peace in your soul? Do you have peace in your soul? Are you certain about what will happen to you in the days ahead of you in your life? Can you have peace going forward? And do you have peace about what will happen to you the moment after you die and step from this life and you step into eternity? Do you have peace about that transaction? Because it will definitely happen to you. One thing I can tell you, every single person in this room, for a fact, if Jesus Christ doesn't return, you're going to die. Merry Christmas. I mean, I know that that's kind of like a, you know, that's kind of a heavy thing, but it's a true thing. And the result of God being with us now is, if God is with you today, he will be with you when you die, and you will be with him when you die. That's the assurance that only Jesus Christ can give you. Do you have that peace in your soul? Do you have that peace? There's a scripture that I want to read in closing from Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 5, and it wraps all four of these precious gifts up in a nice, pretty little Christmas bow for us, okay? And here's the thing. Love, hope, joy, and peace. You can only experience them if you put your faith in Jesus Christ. That's how do I get God with me, Pastor Dave? You get God to be with you by putting your faith and your trust and your life in his hands. And here's the thing. When you accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, God accepts you as his child. And all of these things shall be added unto your life. You won't realize them all at once. You won't know that they're present all at once. But your faith and your hope and your love and your peace and your joy, you hold on and you believe even when you don't see those things and even when it doesn't seem like they're present, they're always with you. Why? Because Jesus is always with you. He said, I will never leave you or forsake you. When you call on his name, he comes to be with you and he comes to stay. And this is what Romans 5, 1 through 5 says this. It says, therefore, since we have faith in Christ. So you can't even get to chapter 5 unless you have the faith that's in chapter 4. But I'm not going to preach a whole message on that. I just want you to know, therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ our Lord has done for us. What's it talking about, Pastor Dave? What Jesus Christ has done for you, he died for you. He gave his life on the cross, like that song, that Christmas Hallelujah song. He bled and he died and he was crucified to satisfy the wrath of a holy God and to pay the price and the penalty for my sin and for your sin. We drove the nails, as Dwayne told us a few Sundays ago, with our disobedience and our rebellion. But when we put our faith in Jesus, his death covers my death and gives me eternal life and brings me to peace with God. And because of our faith, Christ has brought us, I love this, into the place of undeserved privilege where we now stand. That's talking about the grace of God that comes through Jesus Christ. It's a place of undeserved privilege. I'm not saved tonight because I'm a super Christian. I'm not saved tonight because I'm a perfect person. I'm saved tonight because I serve a perfect Savior and a perfect Lord who died for me and has forgiven me because I repented and called on his name. And I am in a place, many of you are in a place of undeserved privilege because of what God has given, because he gave the best gift and the ultimate gift, the gift of his life. That's a good place for you to say amen. Okay, where we now stand, I love that because I'm not cowering in a corner. I'm not running for dear life. I'm standing in the grace of God. And it says this, and we confidently and joyfully look forward to sharing God's glory. I don't know what you're going to get for Christmas tomorrow, but it will not be anywhere near as great as the salvation you have and you will one day realize when you're in his presence. Even if they are really sweet-looking duck boots. Those are great. But heaven's going to look a whole lot better. Better. Not better. Better. Anyway, we can rejoice, too, when we run into problems and trials. Because we know that they help us develop endurance. And endurance develops the strength of character. And character strengthens our confident hope of salvation. How can I hope in God? Because he's never failed me yet. And I know he will never fail me because he's a faithful and loving God. It says this, this hope will not lead us to disappointment, for we know how dearly God loves us because he has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with his love. What a beautiful description of the life brought to us by Jesus Christ. Hope, love, joy and peace. That's the reality of Emmanuel. That's the reality of God with us. And tonight, on the eve of Christmas, let's eagerly anticipate the Lord's return as we celebrate his birth. Let's keep the main thing, and realize that we have received God's love. We should also share God's love. I'm going to ask the deacons to start passing out the candles. I'm going to ask the worship team to come back. And tonight we're going to stand and sing together one of the most beautiful Christmas songs, in my opinion. It's called Silent Night. And as the deacons are preparing, here's how that's going to work. They're going to give you your candle, and I don't know if we'll have enough. We're just going to probably have to give them out to families, but they're going to light the candles at the end of the row. And after your candle is lit, you get to light the candle of the person sitting next to you. So when you get your candle and they light your candle on the end, you pass that light on to the next person. And it's a picture and it's a demonstration of how we can share God's love. The way you share the hope of Christmas, you tell someone about it. You let them know what the real reason for the season is. There isn't a better time to be an evangelist than right now at Christmas. I mean, Jesus' name is in the title of the holiday. It can't get any easier, and it doesn't get any better. And as they're passing out those candles, I'm going to read the Christmas story from Luke chapter 2. It says this in Luke chapter 2, verse 1. This is the greatest story ever told. And it came to pass in those days that a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This census first took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. So all went to be registered, everyone to his own city. Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed wife, who was with child. So it was that while they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born unto you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace and goodwill toward men." So it was, when the angels had gone away from them into heaven, that the shepherds said to one another, "Let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us." And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. Now when they had seen him, they made widely known the saying that was told to them concerning the child. And all those who heard it marveled at those things which were told to them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. Then the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, as it was told unto them. I love that they made it widely known. What's your job this holiday season? First of all, if you have never surrendered your life to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, you've never asked Him to be your Savior, you need to make that happen. You need God to be with you. If you have done that and you are a Christian and you do believe and follow Jesus Christ, then you need to make it widely known the amazing and marvelous things that God has revealed to us in His Word. Amen? Let's stand together. And let's sing this beautiful song of the church, Silent Night. Silent night, holy night. I hope that tonight as you leave this place and return to your home and prepare to spend hopefully a joy-filled day with lots of family and maybe a few close friends, I hope that God with us is the reality of your life. And as you leave, we want to give all the families that came a Christmas ornament that says God with us, and I encourage you that when you go home tonight, that you gather around as a family and read this precious story again and remember as a family that God with us is the reason why we have hope. It's the reason why we understand true love, and it gives us unspeakable joy and indescribable peace during our lives, especially when things don't turn out the way that we plan. Dwayne, you might want to pull one of the trash cans out and have them towards the back and so people can throw their candles away. Unless you want to take it home with you. I don't want it back. So I'm going to close with a poem that was written by a man named David Sorrells. This is Chicken's father who wrote this poem. And as I read it and as we close, I want you to remember to keep Jesus Christ at the center of your life, and especially keep him at the center of Christmas. This poem is entitled, Where is Jesus on Christmas? Is Jesus in all the presents that we've placed so neatly under the tree? Or is he in the kitchen where we're busy as can be? Maybe he's in the lights and stockings that we've hung so very high. Or is he on the rooftop where Santa is in his sleigh waving goodbye? Maybe he's at the shopping mall where you've spent so much time maxing out your credit cards and spending every dime. Or is he at your office party where you think he may not look if you have too much to drink or tell some dirty jokes? Now that we've acted foolish, spent all our money, and wasted lots of time, if only you'd let Jesus be the gift of Christmas, it wouldn't cost you a dime. We go to so much expense and trouble to make Christmas so special and so nice. If we would just let Jesus be our Christmas, he's already paid the price. Would you bow your heads? Lord, I just pray that as we leave this place, that we would not have to search or look too far to find where you are in our lives, in our priorities, and in our holiday, but that you would be at the center of it all. Lord, that the amazing fact of God with us, that that would be the truth of our lives, that that would be the rock that holds our family together. I pray for any person here that doesn't know you as their Lord and their Savior, Lord, that before they leave this moment, Lord, that they would admit that they're a sinner to you, believe that you are the Son of God, that you are the Savior of the world, and that they would confess you as Lord. Thank you for making it. Lord, thank you for making yourself so accessible to us. Thank you for coming to earth, for being born, for living a perfect life, and for dying a perfect death. And I thank you that you rose again, that you're alive, and that you're coming back. Lord, we celebrate you this evening. And Lord, may we follow you all the days of our life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you and Merry Christmas. Hello, my name's Dave and I'm the pastor here at Antioch Baptist Church. I just want to thank you for joining us for this time of praise and worship. I hope that it impacted your life and that it inspired you to take your relationship with God to the next level. If you were watching today and you felt convicted by the Lord to accept Christ as Savior and Lord of your life, I want you to pray this simple prayer with me. Just say, Dear Jesus, I am a sinner. I need you to make me new. I invite you into my life to be my Lord and to be my Master. I believe that you rose from the dead, and I believe that you are the Son of God, and I believe that you will return to the earth again to take me home to be with you. Jesus, thank you for saving me. Thank you for dying for my sin. I receive you now as my Lord and Savior. Amen. If you prayed that prayer and if you responded to that message today, we'd love to hear about it. I want you to contact us here at the church and let us know about the impact that it's had on your life, so that we can celebrate with you and so that we can give you some resources to help you in furthering your walk with Jesus. Thank you so much for tuning in. God bless you. And remember to love, connect, go, and grow.